Okay. So let's get some presentation done.
Ultimate keynote talk starts now.
So I will speak about software synergy with Fiji Image A2 and 9. Four things I will speak about. First, I will ask the question, what one wants to get done and who one is. Then the main part is like about software synergy and how it materializes, at least for me. I give some examples and then a very short like remarks and opinions section. So what do we want to get done? I mean, that's very individual, right? But more important than what to get done is also to see who wants to get stuff done. So there's like me, maybe my boss or my research group, my institute, or the scientific community as such. And we have all slightly different viewpoints on that. And I give you some examples in that order. Let's speak about me. I would like to survive the science business, so I better get some awesome stuff done that is of general interest. But I would also like to do it right and really also finish it and avoid unnecessary overhead. And the talk will be about all this in terms of software and image analysis, right? Image J conference. And on the level of research groups, very similar thing is actually true, just that there are many of me. So we want to get lots of awesome stuff done. And also in a research group, you might be interested in having group members synergize, so work well with each other and do not implement things anew. And on top of that, you might want that knowledge stays alive. So that new people that come into your lab have an easy way to kind of stand on the shoulders of the people that were in this lab before or are still in there. Connect laptop at Lectem. I try to connect laptop. Also, my computer seems to know that I connected this thing. See what happens. Hey. Thank you very much. So, group members should synergize, and then new group members should have an easy way to kind of find their way to work well in this group or exchange ideas. So, an example is the group I'm in. I'm in the Meyers Lab at the MPI CBG in Dresden, and we do all kinds of things. So, my boss does a lot of genome sequencing. I'm not into that. I will not speak about it much. But also, we build microscopes. A lot of SPM microscopy is done in our group. And I will speak a little bit about that, or what comes out of this branch. And we analyze the data coming from our microscopes, like this beautiful flywing that is not a SPM, but it's done in our institute. And we write automated, semi-automated, and manual pipelines that work on that. And I will speak mostly about this. So institute level, so the institute I work for in, they want to how cells form tissues. So there's like really gigantic research questions on an institute level. But important is maybe this. They are willing to develop new technologies if necessary. And that includes our microscopes, but it also includes our pipelines. And they would be very happy if this pipeline is not dying with the paper or with the end of the research project, but if parts can be reused. So software synergy is an important point also from an institute level. So you want to foster collaborations among groups, you want to share knowledge and tools, and you want maybe even to provide facilities where people can go to and get help so that new people can learn from a facility place that usually has a longer lifespan than individuals like postdocs in an institute, how to use and reuse the software that was built already for similar projects in the past. So then why I'm speaking about all this is because in Dresden we really saw that this is necessary, and our vision was that a new lab member comes in, easily understands the framework, has lots of useful software components available, and starts rocking their projects right away. And that is not very easy to do, but it would be great if it would be the case, right? So let's speak about image and data processing. Software synergy, if you benefit from your work, if you benefit from work others did in the past and future projects benefit from your current work, I think that is one aspect of software synergy and the one that I want to focus on. Then we can break it up in like a social aspect and a technological aspect. Technological aspects we heard a lot about in this conference. Like modularize things, make it reusable, image ops, wonderful, right? You write it once, you run it everywhere, all these things we heard in the last 2 days. But the social aspect is also very important. One has to know what was done in the past, where to find it, and how to use it. And there is tons of web pages that Google shows us if we ask how to script for ImageJ or stuff like that. But sometimes it's a bit annoying because there's also all the web pages from 10 years ago that had many hits in the past, so you find them first. So managing all this is not easy. And I have not a solution that I can present. I can just say that we should continue to work on a way to make the entry barrier as low as possible. Status quo in our institute, at the Max Planck Institute in Dresden, we use a ton of different things. Like there are people using Amira, Fiji, ImageJ, NIME, even obscure things like Pluck, which I guess nobody in this room knows. And I will not tell you anything about. We use frameworks like ITK, VTK, OpenCV, Vigra. People use Python and MATLAB, and they are all productive. And orthogonal to this gigantic list, all this like works on Windows, Mac, and Linux. And then since we work with gigantic data, there's also the cluster. So this is massive, right? To deal with all this is not easy. And if a new PhD student comes in our lab, for example, it's really overwhelming initially. So what happens is that you have to build a workflow. I mean, that's a bit of an oversimplified view of everything, but in essence, it's true. You have to think about storage. There might be some hard drive file server, or maybe you're lucky and you have Omero available. Then you do some image processing, so there are many options how to do image processing. Then you have some data that you analyzed, that you like extracted from your images, and you have a bunch of things that you can use there to make sense of what your images contain. And then you visualize it at the very end, or like show it in a paper in the best case scenario. And a person that comes usually does some random subset of these available options. So you might use the file server, write your own algorithms, maybe in Python, and use Cell Profiler because it does exactly what you need for this particular project. And then you use some random tools upstream, and then you publish, and then you have like created this thing. And in a year from now, you don't know anymore how it really worked, and nobody else will ever figure it out. And it essentially dies with you publishing, right? So all the smiley faces that I see at the moment tell me that you know what I'm speaking about. It would be nice if that could be changed, at least partially, right? And I have no answer for that, but myself working with Fiji, ImageJ and NIME for a year now made me hopeful that that is something that could go in the right direction. So what is Fiji? What is ImageJ2? I guess we heard about it yesterday in a wonderful presentation by Curtis. If you didn't see that, then here's the link. You should see it. What I will speak more about is what is NIME. And so I was not planning on speaking very much about it, but I changed my plan after standing at the NIME poster yesterday and speaking with a couple of people. So asking Google what NIME is, it says NIME is open for innovation. Oh, awesome, okay. Another question is, what is NIME image processing? And so I want to explain very briefly what the difference is. So NIME exists for many years and has like thousands of active users and like hundreds of developers and is a massive, amazing tool that I will show you in a second. But it is not thought to be an image processing tool. And NIME image processing is a contribution by a couple of people. It comes from the same place where NIME comes from. But it is a trusted extension of NIME. So if you Google for NIME image processing, you will hit this page. You find many important links there, and I encourage you to do so, just to get to know it a bit. And what you do not see here anymore, but it exists, is like example workflows. And I thought I just open one of them. So you might decide to download NIME, which is done in 10 minutes or so. And then you download this example workflow and you say file import workflow. And then it should be this one here. Then you have a workflow and you open it and it looks easy. So I barely know this workflow, by the way. So I find out what it does together with you. Which is only half true, of course. I looked at it yesterday because I don't want to make a complete fool out of myself. So it roughly contains things that I also want to show. But actually, I didn't produce it or so. I saw it yesterday, the first time in my life. And that also demonstrates that it's maybe cooler. Because if I would open now the same project in source code, that would be painful for all of us. I mean, it would be painful for me to show you, and it would be very painful for you to listen to me. Okay, so maybe it's less painful if I do that. You can tell me later. So what is going on here? First of all, wow, there's something like documentation, and it's like colorful and nice. I'm not sure, it's a bit too small for you to read. Maybe is this true? I don't know, I could maybe like do something like this. And it's also not so important, because what we see here is that we list some files, and then we want to read images, and then we do some segmentation, feature calculation, classification, and some analysis. That looks roughly like the workflow I showed you before, right? So very few basics. If you see an arrow like this one, what goes from here to there is a table. Just imagine an Excel table, okay? With one like difference, each line is a record, a data set, if you want. And these nodes usually like work line by line. So each line, the same algorithm is applied to. And then each column is typed. It might be an integer, it might be an image. And the images, in fact, are data sets or ImageLib2 containers. So it is all very compatible. And I will come to that in more detail later. Very compatible to ImageJ2 and to the ImageLib. So here, tables flow. If you double click on a node, a dialog opens that just shows you what you can set. For example, here you can like set a path to a file or a folder. Awesome. And then you can run it by pushing F7 or right mouse run or the button up here, or the several options. F7 is nice. And then you can look what happened. So we read all the files that were in this folder as file names. So this table has two columns, row ID and location, and the type of location is a string. So if I start this image reader, it will receive this table and go line by line. Let's double click on it. Let's not do that. The image reader itself could just load a folder, but here, since it gets input, it knows and you can configure that which column actually contains the file names. This is all preset. I just hit F7, and then you can see that it takes a couple of seconds to, and actually here I think BioFormats gets used, or Cifio, I guess. So you use what you already use, just in a very different like dress. And now you can say right mouse and you can look at the images. Here they are. It's one column called image, and then you have all these different images read. Alternatively, you can use the table cell view, which is something that comes with NIME image processing. And here, if you now click on one image, you have like possibilities to kind of zoom and look at it and normalize, and it's very image J-ish. Okay, so this is all the data, we loaded it, and now we want to go into the segmentation. What is this? This is a meta node. So if I double click it, I go inside it. And inside, I see that I do segmentation of the nuclei, which is then used to segment the cytoplasm. Okay, interesting. So there is a splitter and a global threshold and a morphological image operation. So this is all kind of speaking to you. I mean, if you never heard about morphological image operations, then probably you have to Google it, but that you would have to do always, right? But in the very first moment, we see that this is like a manageable amount of things that are executed in sequence. And every time you would like to understand what is going on, you can just hit F7, right mouse, table cell view, and then you see what happened, right? You can immediately observe your images, which is a big advantage compared to macros or any other script. You would always have to like debug it. You go to a certain line and like say, okay, and show this image now. Here, this is all like integrated in some sense, which is it's very convenient also for rapid prototyping. So if you're a user, it's very convenient because it's kind of easy to use. If you're a developer, I personally really like it, because if I do some rapid prototyping, all this nice debugging is so easy. Okay, so now I don't go step by step because otherwise this will take forever, but I just go some steps further, hit F7, so it will automatically execute everything it needs to execute the one node where I hit F7 for. So this is also, I could from the very beginning on not care what is really happening. I just push play and the whole thing runs through and most likely writes some files at the very end or so. So let's see what was created here. Aha, we have now individual segments. They have like segment IDs, and later on I will do something with them. Actually, later on is very soon, because here I do some very noise segmentation. And all the functionality so far just is in there. So far, I only combine things that do exist. And later, I will show you ways how to extend that. And also, that is, I mean, we will not actually do it, but you will see that every ImageJ2 plugin is a NIME node automatically, which is nice, right? You write, and this is what Curtis spoke about as well. You write it once and you use it everywhere, but at least in ImageJ and here. And if other people use the same methods that are provided by ImageJ2 Core and by SciJava, then everywhere becomes larger, right? Okay, so let's go out of here. We did obviously some segmentation job, and now we could like feature calculate and we could do all kinds of things. I'm not sure if it makes so much sense to really go through that. I think it would make much more sense if I convinced you now that maybe it's a good half hour for you to just do it, right? Google is your friend. You can easily find it because this is the first hit if you type NIME image processing, and then you download the workflow and you just play with it. Yes. Really? It's a shortcut, yeah. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. So the only thing I wanted to show you is that NIME is a sequence of nodes that can do specific things. You can configure them, and if you connect them to each other, what flows over them is a table of data, And individual cells in this table could be images. But NIME itself, and this is NIME image processing, is everything you need in order to have these table cells that are images and operate on them and like have image J2 integration and image J integration and so on. But NIME itself comes with many, many things. And I just point out a few because I also don't know everything actually. I only use it in a year and I used the things that I needed. But what really came handy for me is the Python, sometimes the MATLAB, and R. So these are the nodes. If you hit into the node repository Python, it just shows you everything that it has. And it has a JSON functionality, so you can do some JSON scripting if this is what you want to do. But it also has a CPython integration, which is very nice. And I even contributed there a bit. If you happen to have a table with images inside and you call a Python script, then the image gets converted into a NumPy array. And you can really work on it, and you even get it back. So if one of your nodes in this complicated workflow is the easiest for you while rapid prototyping, for example, or while you don't care about performance for a solution that you even give a biologist in his hands, you can do that. It's not the fastest. It's for sure better if you would write your own ImageJ2 plugin that does the same thing. But you can, and that is very nice. Yeah. The same is true for MATLAB and R. You can just plot or analyze, do some statistics on data that you extract. ImageJ integration comes, for example, with this very neat node, ImageJ macro. People might be interested in that. And the ImageJ integration, I already mentioned it before shortly, with the ultimate goal of being fully bidirectional, what you have, for example, in the node browser is all the ImageJ2 plugins that are in the default ImageJ2 core. Okay, but basically everything I say, I could say more, and everything is only half true because, of course, there is much more to it. But I think I have to make a stop at some point. The reason why the full bidirectionality really works is that NIME image processing is really using ImageLib2 containers, which is also which are also the image containers for ImageJ2. And SciJava and BioFormats, Cifio, all these kinds of technologies are the basis for NIME and for ImageJ2. How late is it? Okay. Some example projects. Three, actually. I killed other two because it is hopeless to bring five. So I bring three. Provide existing. So what I meant is we have, for example, a pipeline developed for epithelial cell segmentation, and some biologists in our lab really wanted to use it. But the technology that we used to do segmentation that is better than other existing methods was developed by colleagues of mine, and it's a cascaded random forest, whatever. You could read their paper. It's not so important here. The thing is, it's a great new idea, and it works very well. But it was written in like a mixture of some templated C++ code and Vigra, and it's like a mess. This was really done as a computer vision research project, published in a computer vision journal, and completely unusable for anyone that is not the creator or somebody that like really knows what he's doing. It's not even installable easily, right? But what I did is I built this like very, at least colorful workflow, but it's also intuitive if you give yourself 5 minutes to figure out what's going on. And so this part here is about training this cascaded random forest, and this part here is about using it. So once you did that, you saved the workflow, everything is saved, and then later on you just open the workflow, you open the image reader, you say, oh, now work on this image, you go to the image writer, you hit F7, and it's done. So, and why is this interesting? Because inside train cascaded random forest and inside run cascaded random forest, I was able to hide this like very non-Naimish external tool. Let's look inside it. The magic about it is this, external tools. It's a lab contribution, so it's not part of standard Naim, but since Naim is Eclipse, you go on help, install, update, lab contributions, and you have it. It's like 2 minutes. And in here, you can actually put everything that you could start from your terminal, which is nice. So I put all the executables there with all the libraries that are needed so that it is just portable by copying somewhere. And I can give it to somebody that doesn't have to know anything about this stuff. And actually, this person that uses it does not even see it because it's hidden behind this one node. So I think that's convenient. And that certainly is somehow software synergy, right? I make people use things, and I will never have to spend time anymore because people are totally capable of using it themselves, which is good for me. And it's also good for them because they can do it themselves. Yep, and then if you write like a few words on a wiki, then people can even learn how to use it themselves. So they really never come back to me now, right? It's kind of nice. I will not speak about the segmentation pipeline, but together with Christian and Andreas, which is a student of his, and with Tobias, we are also working on a more general purpose segmentation pipeline. And you can also see here, it's kind of all very handy. And of course, there's lots of details inside these meta nodes. But at the very end, we will be able to put a zip file somewhere. People can download it and just import it in the Naim, and they have everything. There's no portability issue. So my second example is avoiding reinventing the wheel. So there is a project that I worked on way too long by now. It's called the Mother Machine. It's a microfluidic device where you put like single bacteria in these like tiny, tiny wells, and then they grow. And the wells are done such that you can like manipulate them, you can like treat them with drugs or different like fluids you can rinse over them, and you can see how cells react. So it's really a tool to study bacteria growth or bacterial behavior, transcription patterns in bacteria, whatever. So you get some data that is not necessarily much beautiful. Yeah, it's not very, it just comes from the microscope. It's not even aligned or anything. So we wrote a Naim workflow to do the pre-processing. I will not go into any details, but after some pre-processing, you have like image sequences like this. Can you see? Is background removed? And the background removal is done basically with functionality that comes with ImageJ. And I just use it programmatically from my own Java. And then we make something super complicated out of it that we have to solve with an integer linear programming solver called Gorobi. The details here are not very important. You could read that in the publications we have. But at the end, it gives you like an automated tracking result. Yellow means that this one cell splits into two cells. Blue means like this cell is this cell is this cell is this cell is this cell. And red, like here, means that this cell was like washed out at the top of the well. And it's almost correct. So with like depending on which segmentation method we use, we can get it almost to the same error level than a human would do it. But it's not 100% correct. So there's also some data curation. I give you one example. So this is a sequence over time, right? And you might look at it and think which cell is which cell. And you are a human, so you're very good. And then you ask our automated solver. And it gives you something weird like this. Can you see? I mean, it kind of doesn't like this. I mean, I will not explain to you why it kind of fucks it up so big time, but it just does it. And if you think about curating this, it's kind of painful, right? I mean, you have to like click many times and say like, no, this is actually this, and this is actually this, which then, I mean, it's like many clicks. I mean, guess how many, like 20 maybe or something. And then you would curate it to something more sensible. And what our tool is actually capable of doing is you go through the time series and then you find this like fuck up and you say like, no, I want this click, one click, okay? And then you see this and you're like, oh, that's hopeless. But wait a second, 1, 2, 3, 4, I mean, here are obviously 5 cells, yeah? So you want just to give this information that there are 5 cells. You click enter And then he finds a solution where actually five cells are segmented here. And it happens that this is the second click, if you want, or five enter is maybe two clicks. So with three clicks, you can completely curate it, and that is fun. So I want to be concerned with coming up with these types of algorithms. This is my job. I'm a computer scientist. I really like solving integer linear programs and do like reasoning systems and whatever. So this is what I want to do. But in order to do that, you can see I had to write all this stuff, and I have to be able to display images and all these kinds of things. If I would do that all myself, this is what I would do most of the time. And it's kind of true. This is what I do at least half of my time. Okay. So the things that I really like to do get buried under things that I really need to do. And this is why I'm also interested in the software synergy aspects. And although this is a standalone app that you can download and run on your Mac or whatever, I saved myself a lot of time by using a software that is available. This is a Maven project, if you want, and I depend on everything these people did, and I'm really grateful that they did it. And I mean, there are many problems, and we could speak about in a confession session about problems with all this. For example, it's when you do it the first time, it's like almost feels like you have to die. It's super complicated, right? But after a while, you get the hang of it, and then it really saves time. I never wrote anything to display images. I just used something that comes somewhere in the ImageLib 2, actually. Yeah. That also the big data viewer uses somehow. And I mean, it's like all one, right? And if you kind of are not scared and you dive into it, then you will necessarily benefit from it. So I think that's one of the main messages. So it is really important to acknowledge the power of this, not only in using it in a tool like ImageJ2, where all these technologies are in there, but you can kind of come on very different levels, right? NIME comes on top of SciJava and uses it in order to have every op being a node. Cute, right? But if you want to do your own tool, you can also stand on the shoulder of giants, right? And use all this stuff that was done by other people. That brings me to my third and last example, giving back, right? So there's no, I mean, nobody stops you from just leeching all this stuff that exists and publishing your papers, but you should at least feel a bit bad. Right? So, okay, how can I give back? I don't know. I mean, maybe I give back somehow by developing the tool and then make other people that have actually mother machines and work on bacteria research enable them to use my tool, right? This is one way of giving back. But then there are also other ways. So let's speak a bit about the microscopy stuff we did. And I did it with a few of my colleagues. So we built microscopes, I told you. And they are SPIM microscopes, so you kind of get volumetric data out of your light microscope. And that looks like this. So here you have a C. elegans embryo in your microscope, and you kind of see while it acquires Z stacks, you see them. And it's kind of cool, but it's also kind of painful, right? You get these beautiful 3D images, and you see it like this. So what we wanted to have, I mean, it was not actually, I started a bit later. So the project was started by the colleagues that really did the microscopy. They wanted to see it more like this, right? Live. While the microscope is still acquiring images, they would like to look at it in 3D and maybe see, oh, hopeless, and end the 12-hour acquisition after 1 hour and do one that is not hopeless or something like this, right? And the nicest thing about this, they went along and they just did it. So they came up with a volume renderer and can also do isosurfaces that like uses GPUs with OpenCL and CUDA, and they came up with this wonderful tool where you take a volume from disk or from the scope directly, and they max project it. But they max project it in arbitrary directions so that you have that it looks like 3D. It feels like 3D, you can really use it. And I will just, because it's awesome and I have another 5 minutes, I will tell you a bit about this max projection, just because it's nice. and nobody stops me. So for each pixel, you know in which direction you look through the volume. And now you can do different things. You could, for example, just go through along this line and just look for the one place with the maximum intensity and then display it. And that looks like this. If you refresh fast, right? So can you see? This thing comes from like the outside towards the projection screen. So this is when I zoom to it, it kind of gets displayed like this, right? In a slow pass. Which is a bit annoying, because now you imagine you have this thing in 3D, you kind of roll around, and it always like looks like this. It gives you a kind of weird feeling. So an alternative would be to do the rendering successively. So instead of like going one voxel after another, you go to this voxel and to the one a bit further, a bit further, a bit further, and then you interleave, like I displayed it here. And that would look like this. Can you see? I don't know. Might be better. But it's still weird. Didn't change so much. So what we came up with is a colleague of mine came up with is the Fibonacci multipath. And that tries to sample such that the distance between the maximum distance between two sample points that I used so far is minimized at every time point. And that would look like this. I hope you can see that. It looks more pleasant. And also, if you plot the error over the number of passes you did, you see that you're always closer to the image where you looked at every voxel, right? And then while we use it in clear volume, every time we kind of rotate, we just do these passes. But as soon as you want to continue to rotate, we stop and we start anew. So we can like, you don't have to render the complete image and then have a very like not so nice way of like rolling around. Here for your eyes, you never see that you actually never see the full resolution. We just stop earlier and we display what we have so far. Then we start anew, and if you have enough time, when I stop here, then it suddenly gets like a bit crisper. But it is so good that actually, as long as you don't look at my screen, but only here, and you are further back, you might not even see the difference. So there is a lot of time in there, and then I could say, yeah, we have it. We can do what we want, and I could stop there. And it almost happened, but then we thought, nah. Nah, we should give back, right? And then we spent time to kind of build frameworks and different language bindings so that people could use it when they install it, but it's all kind of standalone. So we thought, in addition, we should probably give it back to Fiji and to Nime. And we did. So there's a Fiji plugin for Clear Volume where you can basically show your volumetric data. And there are some caveats to it. So it, since our displaying framework needs Java above 1.6, and that is at the moment a bit of a problem in Fiji. That will take a bit before it is like not painful anymore, but in principle it exists, and you can look it up if you like Clear Volume, Google, you find a list of you find how to install it. In Nime it's a bit easier. Every node you click on it. You show this table cell view that I showed you before, and then if you installed also Clear Volume from the Nime installer, you just have it. Okay, that brings me to the end, and I have 2 minutes. It's amazing. I didn't know if I would have a 30 minutes or 1.5 hour presentation, and I have a 45 minute presentation. I'm very happy. Okay, I spoke about mostly this part. And that is because I know about this part, and I worked with this part. But really, the whole slide that we saw yesterday is true. And your software synergy might happen between different nodes, or all of them, or a different subset, or on a different level. But if you do it right, you can benefit from code that already exists by learning a bit of like how to get it. And then if you learn a bit more of how to kind of contribute to it, then you can even make your stuff available to others. And I think if you all would do that for a while and make these things better, then at some point maybe they are not even painful anymore, which at the moment they really are. But the pain is usually over faster than you would develop it on your own from scratch. And this is something you don't see necessarily, because at the beginning you are sometimes maybe, I happen to be like this. I always thought, this is relatively easy, right? And then I start, and then it's not so easy. And it ends up being as complicated as the stuff that somebody else did that I didn't want to read the code because it seems so complicated, right? So I think that's something that is wrong. We just think wrongly about that. So I think it's always good to take a bit of time to read the code of others, because most likely they are not so stupid after all. And you would end up doing exactly the same thing. So that's all awesome, but the whole software, I think this is what I already said. It's very confusing, and we need to make it easy to be part of it. And people try that, and like the ImageJ wiki is amazing. There is so much information there. The problem is that the internet is full of stuff that is like 10 years old, and you find it. And you don't know if you are like very new, and I did other things for my PhD than I do now. So like a couple of years ago, I started image analysis stuff. And I found a lot of things, but I didn't know what to trust. So I think we should really find solutions of making like the entry easier for people. And on top of that, if it should be of interest for research groups, institutes, and whole communities to foster these kind of contributions. So if you have a PhD student, like kick him to use it, right? Instead of writing his own Python stuff. And he will say thanks in half a year. But the first half year, it will be a pain, that's for sure. But doing all the stuff that would take him half a year in a year is not less painful. It just seems as if it would be a good idea in the very first moment, but maybe it is not. And then yesterday there was a question, how can I contribute? And a partial answer is most likely something like this. Use stuff that exists and give credit. Make your own contributions available, and if you can, which you cannot if you're a PhD student, but if you grow older, then at some point you can hire developers and get funding, right? And make the existing tools better.
I thought of one other answer to that question.
Yes.
Because I was thinking a lot since my talk yesterday. Another thing you can do is, if you're technically savvy but limited time, limited resources, you can choose a couple of plugins, maybe even just one plugin that's in Fiji that you love and use all the time, but nobody else is taking care of it, and decide it's your plugin now, you're going to take care of it. Doesn't mean adding tons of stuff. It just means making sure it keeps working. It's called being a maintainer. Fiji has hundreds of plugins, so if you maintain one, it helps.
Yeah, it's a good idea, actually. Yeah. What is Patenschaft in English? Like, you can decide to have like an African child you send money and letters to. Thank you, Slide. Thank you very much. So there are the people that are around me and closest to me and I work most with that I want to thank to. My group and Tobias Peach, who is just amazing, and without him I would probably die. Stefan Saalfeld and Christian Dietz, who together with like 1.5 other people created NIME for image processing, and he couldn't be here, and this is, I guess, why I got this slot. Otherwise he would speak to you. And Jean-Yves, I didn't show an example, but I want to thank him anyway for the example I did not show. And Michael Berthold is the guy that invented NIME and also the boss of Christian. And Carsten Rother, because he's a computer vision guy and I work with. But the real thanks is to the much longer list than the icons I depict here is to all the people that contribute to projects that I leech from when I write my own project. And that's the end. Thank you very much.